technology solutions for a 2-degree world, invested in renewables, storage, energy efficiency, and carbon capture and storage. Really, what we're going to do now is start to frame the discussion that we want to have after this COP21 process. We all want to know what internationally collaborative actions, policies, and investments are needed by the energy sector to deploy low carbon technologies on a global scale. So we want to ask, do those solutions exist, or should we hold on for breakthrough new technologies? And we're going to ask that question to you in a minute. I'm very pleased to introduce to you the speakers and panel that we have. Closest to me, Philippe Benoit, from the International Energy Agency, Head of Energy Efficiency and Environment Division, Ajah, Ghambhir, Senior Research Associate at the Grantham Institute and Imperial College London, Beatriz, Fernandez, Philippe member of the Institute of Chemical Engineers, Stefaan, Simons, who is Dean of the College of Engineering, Design and Physical Sciences at Brunel University, John Scowcroft, Global Carbon Capture and Storage Institute, by Mathieson, the Danish Society of Engineers, and Tom Jennings, Director, Policy, Markets and Innovations for the Carbon Trust. We're going to hear from each of those in a short while. So, we've all heard this week that reducing greenhouse gas emissions to a level where atmospheric concentrations provide for 2 degrees or, of course, 1.5 degrees global warming requires the deployment and development of a broad portfolio of mitigation and technology solutions. Many of the technologies needed are already in use or in a mature stage of development, but in order to achieve the necessary emissions reductions, many of these technologies will need to be deployed at a large scale by 2020, when this Paris Agreement is expected to start. And certainly all of them must be commercially available within that decade. Clearly, strong policy and investment decisions are required now to enable this to happen. Before we start, I should say that the Grantham Institute, my name, I should tell you, is Martin Siegert. I'm the co-director of the Grantham Institute at Imperial College London. Pleasure to host you here. We are just about to launch a new policy paper on energy storage, and we're going to distribute it to everybody that's here after this session next week. So if you want to receive a copy, please drop your card in. There'll be a place at the back of the room to put a business card or send us your email address. I see on the screens there are hashtag climate tech, hashtag COP21, and a whole stream of Twitter accounts. Please feel free to do the tweeting, and broadcast will be about to tell you in due course. So here is our speakers. Very good. And so an audience poll, just before we start, this is what we'd like to do. Do you believe that the solutions, the technical solutions to reducing greenhouse gas emissions, do they already exist? I'd like a show of hands if you think those technology solutions already exist. Please put your hands up. I'm not going to count. Okay, and hands up if you think they don't exist and we need R&D and new technologies. Slightly less than half believe that new technologies are needed. About half, well, more than half, clearly. A few undecided. Who believe that we've got the technologies. Well, we're going to test that toward the end of this session as well. So without further ado, please welcome to the stage our first speaker and our keynote speaker, Philippe Benoit from the International Energy Agency.
Thank you, Martin. It's a real pleasure to be here to discuss this very important issue of technological innovation. So let me just get into the thick of things. As you know, we at the IEA basically try to model how we can decarbonize our energy sector in order to limit emissions to a pathway that's consistent with 2 degrees. And so what we do is we basically run a variety of models that look at assumptions regarding cost of different technologies. And actually, let me just add, embed in them a certain amount of improvement in technologies. And we try to figure out an effective way to get from a pathway at the top of the line that would have been consistent with the 6 degrees to an emissions pathway out of the energy sector that is consistent with 2 degrees, which is basically the lower bounded line. And in that regard, we conclude that there are a variety of key technologies that can contribute to a cost-effective way to decarbonize our energy sector. That includes the various technologies that we're going to be discussing today. Energy efficiency, renewables, CCS, from our perspective, they all have an important role to play. Now, as you know, in connection with these Paris discussions, we have all been very, very pleased, I think, and many surprised when we consider where we were a year and a half ago, to see so many countries submit their intended nationally determined contributions, which from our perspective provide a real basis to figure out where are we going in terms of current pledges, for want of a better word, from countries. And in that regard, what we have done is we have modeled where these pledges, these contributions, would take us in terms of emissions out of the energy sector. And that's what you have reflected in the blue line. Now, there are two important points that I would like to note with respect to that blue line. The first is that what you see is a fundamentally a plateauing of emissions, ever so slowly increasing still over time, but yet almost getting to the point where we're achieving a plateau. The second thing is that when we analyze and we make assumptions as to where we would be beyond 2030 and the actions that would take place beyond 2030, we believe that this would lead us to a global temperature increase in the ranges of 3 or above beyond, in terms of long-term increases, by around 2100, 2.7, but still increasing after that. The big point here is that in order to achieve our 2-degree pathway, we need to do a lot more. And in that regard, we believe that innovation, further innovation, will be critical in order to make that path cheaper and also to make it physically easier to do. Now, when we think about technological innovation, it's important to understand that from our perspective, different technologies require different forms of support at different points. So, for example, technologies in their early phase of development, with little market penetration, such as CCS, require stronger research and development and public sector support. As they become more mature and they start to become integrated into our markets, the nature of that support can diminish and change. So, for example, offshore wind may be providing, needing more in terms of feed-in tariffs and the like. As we get to more mature technologies, such as onshore wind and the like, we can see lesser amounts of support, leading to the point where you have fundamentally relatively mature technologies with high degree of potential market integration, such as energy efficiency, where still barriers remain and things such as labeling programs and other activities will be important. But the fundamental point here is that we need to adapt the policy support to the particular technology, taking into account where that technology is in terms of its development, as well as in terms of market penetration. Now, what are the type of advantages that we see can come out of further support for technological innovation? It can often present important changes in the way we look at issues. What you have here are our assumptions regarding the type of cost reductions that we could see out of CCS starting in 2020, assuming that between now and then we see significant improvements and significant deployment of CCS. The big point here is that fundamentally it can help change some of the competitive ways we look at it. So for example, what you have here on the right is comparing coal with CCS to combined cycle. A lot of discussion about fuel switching, moving from coal to gas, but fundamentally what we see is that if we can push the innovation of CCS, we can end up in a situation, in particular in Asian markets, where at a relatively low price of carbon at about $35, coal plus CCS becomes competitive with gas, assuming again these type of technological innovations that can drive down the price of CCS. And the important point to realize and to recognize is that coal plus CCS is actually 4 times cleaner than combined cycle gas. So innovation can provide important game changers in terms of our decisions on a low carbon future. That's in terms of technological innovation. But it's also important to recognize that we need to be innovative in terms of our policies as well. So, for example, when we think about integrating high levels of variable renewable energy into our systems, in fact, we have a lot of the technologies that we need. The problem we have is that fundamentally, when we think about renewables, we think about a fossil-based system and adding renewables to that fossil-based system. We need to fundamentally change the way we look at our system and take more of an integrative approach in which we look at transmit generation, transmission, demand-side issues, and storage, and to develop policies that are designed to have a system in which variable renewables become a fundamental part of our system. We believe this is achievable. It requires looking at our policies differently. And in fact, we have a publication called The Power of Transformation that looks at this very issue. In addition to innovation, we are going to need funding. What you have here is where we project funding for the electricity sector will go under a business as usual case. In some ways, this is really consistent with the INDC cases that we have. In order for us to get to that 2-degree line, we are going to need to see a significant shift of about $4 trillion from fossil fuel type investments into clean energy. Another important area is the area of energy efficiency. We project that under current policies and practices over the next 22 years, we would be seeing investments in energy efficiency of about $8 trillion. But in order to get that decarbonization, to get the decoupling of GDP growth, which is an important integral assumption in all our models in OECD countries as well as in emerging economies, we're going to need to see significant additional investment in energy efficiency from $8 trillion under a business as usual case to $14 trillion. All of these will require that we have not only policy innovation, but we also fundamentally change the way we look at energy efficiency and our appreciation for this issue. Having said that, at the IEA, we also try to be pragmatic. We recognize that fossil fuels are a part of our present. They are likely to remain a part of our future, and that is embedded in our model. But what does that mean in terms of achieving a 2-degree future? Basically, as opposed to a large amount of fossil fuel consumption and production that we would see in a 6-degree world, we need to be looking at significantly less fossil fuel production and consumption going forward. But we believe that we can expect to see continued fossil fuel production, and obviously that's reflected in a lot of the investment decisions that are being made in emerging economies. So, how do we decarbonize that type of production? What is critical will be carbon capture and storage. What you have here, building over time, is the amount of carbon capture and storage that is added to coal and gas electricity production. But let me just add here that it's important to recognize that carbon capture and storage is not simply a question in the power sector, but will be an important tool in industrial activities. The chemical processes that we need to produce cement, steel, they create CO2 emissions. We will need carbon capture and storage in those areas as well. The other thing is we need to realize that the world of the future will be different than the world we have today in terms of geographical distribution issues on the energy side. At the IEA, we project that over 95% of future growth in energy demand will take place outside of the OECD. And as a result, we need to focus on decarbonization activities there, and that's why in our modeling, 70% of decarbonization, low emissions activities take place outside of the OECD. This is an important shift in geography that we need to always bear in mind. And finally, as we have today, as we sit here today and we think about the discussions in Paris, I think one of the big things that we need to sort of recognize is the fact that the numbers are changing. We're starting to talk no longer simply about 2 degrees, but about well below 2, about 1.5. This will present an important challenge. We need to think about a world not simply of that is characterized and defined by achieving the 2 degrees. I think Martin, you captured it very well in terms of changing the title of this presentation, this whole overall discussion we're having today. What are some of the implications as we try to move from a 2-degree world to potentially a world well below 2? It'll have big issues in terms of energy efficiency, renewables, how we structure our economies, and I know this is something that the panel will discuss today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Philip, for that introductory set of remarks. I'm going to very briefly present, just over the next 5 minutes or so, on two research projects that I and colleagues at the Grantham Institute at Imperial College London have been involved in over the last 2 years. The first is called the Avoiding Dangerous Climate Change Project, and that gives us a sense through the energy modelling that we used about the rate of decarbonisation that we would need to give us a good chance of meeting the 2 degrees goal. We haven't yet looked at the rate of decarbonisation that we need to meet the 1.5 degrees goal, but we have the framework to do so, and that's certainly something that we'll be turning our attention to at the end of this week and early next week, depending on how the Paris text develops over the next 24 hours or so. So let's think about 2 degrees. We know that we need to decarbonise very quickly if we're going to meet our carbon budget for the 21st century. Now, I won't try and give you too many figures, but just bear in mind that the analysis suggests that we've got something like 800 to 900 billion tonnes of CO2 from fossil fuel combustion and industrial processes left to emit for the remainder of this century if we're to have a fair chance of staying below 2 degrees. And as many of you will be aware, research has shown that this year we emitted about 35 billion tonnes of CO2 from those sources, just slightly down on last year, obviously excellent news, but the maths is fairly easy. If we're emitting 35 billion tonnes a year and we've got about 850 billion tonnes left, that gives us something like 20 to 25 years of emissions at the rate that we're currently going at. So that means we need to really bend the curve downwards and decarbonise fast. And what does that actually mean? Well, if we actually started global coordinated action in 2020, then across the three energy models that we've looked at, which is our own, IASA's message model and FEAM's which model, for those of you that know about these models, we see rates of decarbonisation in the decade 2020 to 2030, which range from 2 to 9% a year globally. If we start global coordinated action in 2030, from a level of emissions broadly consistent with what the INDCs are adding up to now, then we'd see rates of decarbonisation more like 7 to 14% a year. Now, can we do this? The honest answer is I don't know. Have we done this in the past? At a global level, no. At a country level, Sweden, for example, has decarbonised at 4% a year on average, and that was in the decades 73 to 83 following the oil crisis. But we'd need to go at that kind of speed globally, even if we start in 2020. So the challenge is immense. What would that actually mean in terms of technologies? Well, again, we've looked across these three energy models, and we've looked at the average global number of gigawatts per year of those technologies shown, gas with carbon capture and storage all the way through to solar, that would be deployed in a lowest cost scenario in these circumstances. So looking at the top right there, the blue rectangle, we would see rates of technology deployment ranging from 20 to 80 gigawatts a year of these technologies. But if we delay action to 2030, then those rates at least double. We're looking at rates of maybe up to 160 gigawatts a year of gas with CCS in the decade 2030 to 2040, that first decade following the start of international coordinated action. This is a huge, huge ask. Of course, the global economy and the global energy system will be bigger in that period in 2020 or 2030 compared to the historical period, which I'm showing figures for there, 2000 to 2010. That's how fast, on average, per year, globally, we deployed those technologies shown, with coal at 50 gigawatts a year being the technology that we built the most of. So that gives you a sense of the scale of the challenge. Have we got the skills, supply chains, material, financial and legal know-how to achieve this? I'll leave that question open. Another project that I've been involved with over the last couple of years, mostly focused on the last 6 months actually, is the Global Apollo Programme proposal, which was a proposal by a number of UK business, academic and other leaders, and they have suggested that we need a big increase in public research, development and demonstration in order to bring down the costs of key low carbon technologies, including solar, wind, storage and smart grids. Now, we know, following on from Philip's comments, that certain technologies are brought down in cost through certain processes over time, depending on their maturity and phase of market development. We've taken that into account to think about what impact the Apollo program proposal, which would be about $150 billion of funding over the next 10 years for RD&D, research, development and demonstration, what that would actually do to solar costs with associated storage so that you can actually get reliable electricity supply from solar. And what that chart shows is that compared to 2015 estimates of utility scale solar costs, in a couple of years' time by 2017, solar is already going to be just over half of that cost. So solar costs are falling very, very fast, and that's because of scale and learning by doing in deploying utility scale solar. We think that over the next 10 years or so, without the Apollo RD&D funding push, solar and storage costs will still come down significantly. But with the Apollo program, there is a scenario which is plausible, we think, whereby solar and storage, even without a carbon price or any support, could actually get to coal grid parity by the middle of the next decade. And that could be very exciting, because looking at the inset chart, what this shows is the share of global electricity generation from solar in that scenario, in the red bars where the Apollo funding is applied. And that shows that as early as 2040, solar could be generating a quarter of global electricity generation. And remember, that's without a carbon price. So I wanted to present those two insights from recent programs to really set the context for my colleagues this morning and to show that we are facing a huge challenge, but that we do have a number of technologies which are making that challenge more feasible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ajah, for your presentation. Today I would like to give you all a different perspective besides technologies. And today I would like to present to you the Future Climate Engineering Solutions Project. This is a global network of professional engineering associations. We are developing energy and climate plans that are helping the governments to achieve the commitments to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and to reduce the dependence on fossil fuels. These plans certainly consider the deployment of low carbon technologies, the use of renewable energies, but also consider energy strategies for efficiency and management in sectors such as building and transport. This project is recognizing that in order to plan a national energy system and the responses to climate change, it must be based on engineering data, on evidence, and not sometimes, as it is the case, in unfounded assumptions or a short time experience. Therefore, these database plans are providing the numbers that are taken from agencies such as the International Energy Agency, from global institutions and even from governments, in order to map out the pathways that each country can follow in order to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and in order to achieve the targets that each government has committed to. One additional thing of these plans is that we're not only taking into account, as I said earlier, the deployment of low carbon technologies, we're also considering some sectors that typically are omitted from supply-side energy plans, such as water, food, transport, waste management station, manufacturing, recycling, agriculture. All these sectors are considered in these energy and climate plans. And obviously, the plans are aligned with the IPCC scenario of keeping a global temperature rise within 2 degrees Celsius. And here you can see in my slide a representation of the countries that are already part of this global network. We have 23 countries, and those include developing and developed countries. But now the question is, how do we fit in the climate change debate at COP21? 2 days ago at the World Federation of Engineering Organizations Engineering Summit, the chairman of the Committee on Engineering and Environment, Darren Dunnelly, was present here today. He said that yes, engineers can produce energy efficiency and energy technology solutions, but the message at COP21 has to be that engineers need to put words into action. And to this powerful message from the Future Climate Engineering Solutions Project, we would like to add that we want to, that engineers should put words into action with numbers. And that's exactly what this project is about. It's about providing data, it's about providing science data-based engineering plans, and to work in collaboration with governments and with industry stakeholders in order to achieve the commitments of reduction of greenhouse gas emissions and the transition to low carbon economies. The power, obviously, of this network is that because we have a global representation, we can work at national level, and that the people that are part of these engineering associations have the industry experience, know the field, they have the understanding, and because this is a non-for-profit organization, we're not biased. The plans are completely objective. As you all know, in preparation for the 21st Convention of Parties, the UNFCCC under the Adopt Working Group on their Durban Platform for Enhanced Action, the ADP, they invited the countries to submit the Intentionally Nationally Determined Contributions, the INDCs. There are different numbers, but according to the latest report from the UNFCCC, there have been 158 INDCs submitted, and that's actually representing 186 parties. And obviously, achieving these INDCs will have impact in the Sustainable Development Goals. We have heard from AJ, and we will hear from our panelists. Data and science-based plans in order to support them to the implementation of real, concrete, and practical actions to achieve the targets that they commit at COP21. Our ultimate goal, as I've been saying, is to work in collaboration with the governments, with industry stakeholders, and with other parties in order to support them, in order to provide data and plans that can map out those scenarios, those pathways, in order to achieve the greenhouse gas emissions reductions. We are here today as engineers, raising our voice in the climate change debate. We're doing so with data, with information, with concrete plans, and as this new, the next step is the implementation, we believe we have a critical and active role to play in the development of plans that can help the governments to succeed in the commitments of achieving greenhouse gas emissions, to transition to low carbon economies, and also to achieve national but also international binding targets that in the end is giving us and leaving us with a sustainable future. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm here today representing the Institution of Chemical Engineers, as chair of their new energy centre. The Institution of Chemical Engineers has something like 46,000 members across 120 nations around the world, many of whom are involved in various parts of the energy system, and the word system is important here. So we formed this energy centre because we really believe that chemical engineers can provide or help provide many of the solutions required to limit temperature rise below 2 degrees, and so we're delighted to be here at COP21 at the heart of these negotiations. Today's newspapers tell us that an agreement is proving elusive. We've still got 24 hours to go, so hopefully solutions can be found, but whatever happens, we as chemical engineers are ready to support policymakers in transforming what Beatrice just said, words into action. Just very quickly, if I may, just explain what chemical engineers and chemical engineering is all about, and that's a real challenge to do that in a minute or two. But chemical engineers are involved in the design, building and operation of plants and processes that convert raw materials into the products that we're all familiar with and use on a daily basis, from the coatings on the walls of this room to the materials that are in your iPads, computers and iPhones. So this kind of transformation process requires a lot of energy. So chemical engineers are very used to dealing with large amounts of energy. Energy needs to be put into these processes to convert these products. Also, a lot of energy comes out of these processes. And all that energy means that a great majority of the production costs, 80% of the production costs, is based on the energy. So as chemical engineers, we take a systems approach to make sure that we use this energy as efficiently as possible. And so where we have energy outputs, we use that energy for our energy inputs. So the reason I wanted to explain that is that we take a very systematic approach, and we believe that the technologies are available today to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to reach the 2-degree target. Now we're hearing 1.5 degrees C, so we've really got to transform these words into action. And we are familiar with this IEA picture here of what the future energy system could look like, and it's not going to be very far away from us now. Chemical engineers are involved in every aspect of that picture there. One thing that's missing, I think, is the role that large energy users like the chemical industry can play in balancing such a system. As I said, there's a lot of energy that's produced from the chemical process, a lot of energy that's stored in its products. So there's a role there for chemical engineering and chemical engineering process plants to play in that balancing of that future energy low carbon system. So the message we're getting across is that we believe the technologies are here today for us to produce the low carbon system. We have come up, as the Energy Centre, we have come up with a number of priority topics. They're listed here on the slide. You can see that carbon capture and storage is on there. I'm going to leave that for others to talk about more. Certainly there's a lot of research and development that's going on in CCS within chemical engineering departments around the world and universities. Utilisation is also in there. We believe that there is a role for CO2 utilisation, but it's going to be a small part to play. Energy efficiency is really of interest. I mentioned that chemical plants use a lot of energy. Actually, it's the most energy intensive industrial sector that we have. And even though we are very efficient at what we do, 60% of the energy use, the energy demand, is wasted. So we really can do a lot more with the energy efficiency aspects, and certainly in the chemical sector, a great deal of energy, 5 to 11 exajoules per year, just by using the technologies that we have today, can be saved. What we need is the strong policies to drive us towards those goals. So underlying all this, of course, is collaboration. We're going to need a lot of collaboration worldwide to get these technologies out there and the systems in place to deliver our targets. And that collaboration also needs to involve communities, a lot of community engagement. So underlying all this is what is known as open innovation. We came up with a climate communique. That's available on this side events website. It's also available at the IChemE's website, should you want to download that, where we state our position for the Energy Centre. So just to finalise, we believe, as Beatrice does, that it's now time for engineers to really step up to the plate and say, we can convert these words into action. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's a particular pleasure for me, having spent the last 20 years in the environment and climate change community, to follow a chemical engineer. I discovered when I started this that most of the environmental managers in the power sector are chemical engineers, and I asked why, and they told me it's because we like measuring things. I'm a historian, I just like reporting things. Briefly, the Institute, the Global Carbon Capture and Storage Institute, is some 4 or 5 years old. Its mission is to accelerate the demonstration deployment of carbon capture and storage technologies. And we do this through a mixture of fact-based advocacy and the establishment of knowledge sharing networks amongst practitioners. Our membership is broad. It's drawn from governments, from utilities, from oil and gas industries, from equipment manufacturers, academics, and we have a close relationship with some of the environmental NGO community. So I want to really put over 3 points in this brief presentation. First of all is CCS is needed, it's here, but it does need a strong policy framework and support to ensure its large-scale deployment. So CCS is indispensable for a least cost approach to global decarbonisation. I think there's general agreement that the fossil energy cannot continue to be used unabated, and that therefore CCS is a critical mitigation option that can help all fossil energy dependent countries to reduce emissions. I think the other thing we need to bear in mind is that when looking at this, is we must recognise that fossil fuels are expected to still provide some 75% of the world's primary energy needs in 2040, albeit declining from its current 80%. Therefore, clearly investments over the medium term in unabated fossil energy assets have a very high potential to determine the future global emissions signature. And this is important because temperature rises will be driven by the cumulative stock of emissions over this period. So that's why it's needed. It's here. There are some 12 operating projects around the world. We expect there will be some in the next 2 or 3 years. There will be 17 operating projects, and there are some more in the pipeline. And whilst most of these projects are in the non-power sector, the very first project in the power sector has demonstrated that in that first project, that subsequent project will be some, according to the people operating that plant, the capital cost will be some 30% cheaper, and they are having an energy penalty lower than we have to see. But when we looked at the title for this presentation, and we have 2 degrees, it was still, as far as we are concerned, an enormous task. Because although if you look at the INDCs, there is some evidence that there is CCS requirements. But remember, those INDCs mainly go to 2025 and 2030. And it is really in subsequent INDCs that the real need for CCS will be demonstrated. Now, I've done in my past some modelling on decarbonisation of the power sector. And one of the things I find a problem with models is they have this thing called perfect economic foresight, which means 2035 we need CCS, it's there, and it's miraculously, yes, A, the necessary capital available and the necessary technology there. I think what I'm saying is if we don't start now, in 2035, CCS will not be ready for large scale deployment. And the other thing about that is deployment is not a technology challenge. The CCS technologies have been around for some years. It's a policy-driven technology, and therefore we need policies that spur investment, and they are the missing pieces in the jigsaw. And the other point which Philippe made in his presentation is we're not just looking at the power and energy sector. There are other ways of decarbonising the power sector. But for some industrial processes, there is no other way of decarbonising steel or cement without CCS. Therefore, its deployment is not purely an energy sector issue, it's an industrial sector issue. And the other point is, again, that if you look at where the IEA say the deployment is going to take place, most of the deployment of CCS in the future will need to be in non-OECD countries. It's about 70% to 30% between non-OECD and OECD countries. Therefore, there is an important issue
they're about getting the technology widespread.
Should we go?
Now, one of the things I said, it's a policy-driven technology, and what we think we need is some kind of policy parity for CCS along with all the other technologies. So what do we need for that policy? We need predictable and enduring policy arrangements. Shifts in policy can have a devastating effect on the deployment of technologies. We need effective and cost-efficient CC law and regulation. One of the issues about CCS is there is a slight disconnect between building a plant and finding the storage potential. It can take you up to 10 years to identify and categorize a storage site. Once again, if we don't start now, we're going to run into problems. It's also been mentioned that we need R&D, which will reduce the cost and increase the efficiency. And when you look at hubs and clusters, what I mean by there is, if I take a UK example, the Humber Valley provides 20%, or is responsible for 20% of the UK's carbon emissions. You don't just build one pipeline for one power station, you need to look at the potential other sources of CO2, and in many industrial applications, the carbon actually comes in a pretty pure state, so the capture issue is not great. On the other hand, they are small quantities, and will you find the necessary incentive to build the necessary pipelines? Therefore, a hub and cluster approach for this technology. So at that point, I think I've probably used my time, and I'll thank you for your attention.
Hello, I'm Brian Mathieson. I'm representing the Danish Society of Engineers. In my daily life, I'm a professor of energy planning, and I work with energy systems modeling in a group where we have focused on large-scale integration of renewables for 25 years. So what I will try and do today is to present what work we have collaborated with the Danish Society of Engineers with, and what kind of research is behind. And I hope that you will all come out with an understanding that a lot of the technologies that we need are actually present. So what we work with is some different strategies for providing a sustainable development within the energy sector. Now, there are three things that we need to focus on. One of the things is to save energy. So energy savings is a key challenge. And this is not rocket science. This is known technology. It is something we can go out and do. Of course, there has to be regulation that develops products and policies, but there are a lot of technologies available. The other thing we need is we need more efficient power plants. So, and we need more efficient vehicles. So we need to change internal combustion engines with electric vehicles. We need to have more efficient transport systems. We need to have more efficient power plants. But what also is important is that we change from using boilers to using heat pumps. So we need to totally rethink the way we do energy conversion. The third component is, of course, renewable energy sources. As you all know, if we simply start replacing all of our fossil fuels with biomass, we're not going to end up in anywhere good, in any good situation. So we need to have a very large scale employment of renewables. And this creates a huge problem for us, because you can imagine if we, on the one hand, save a lot of energy, make our conversion more efficient, and on the other side want more intermittent renewable energy sources, we have a huge challenge. And I believe that we're able to meet this challenge if we fundamentally rethink the way the energy sector is structured. If we look at savings, we have to realize that there's something called cost efficiency. this idea that we will save the world with passive houses or plus energy buildings, it may be true, but it is also extremely expensive. So we need to look at what is a credible solution regarding having a very ambitious way to do energy savings, and what are the costs of supplying, for example, renewable heat. We have done that in a Danish case for the Danish Society of Engineers in what is called the IDA Energy Vision. We have also done that on a European scale. We have made a study called Heat Roadmap Europe, and it turns out that Europe is wasting heat. So there's actually enough waste heat from power plants, from industries, that could supply the entire building stock of Europe if we were simply able to transport the heat. There are technologies to transport the heat. It's called district energy. And this is not new technology, this is known technology. So these are the kind of things that we need to start focusing on. How do we deploy on a large scale technologies that we actually know? When we look at these kind of energy systems, we need to really go into detail. So we do that. We model these systems 8,760 hours per year, from the electricity to transport to heat to the intermittent sources. And what we find is that we can identify systems where we are able to convert to very large scale renewable energy, and also going the full way towards 100% renewables. Now, this is my message here. I think we need to change our understanding fundamentally, that it is possible to supply the world resources by combining energy efficiency measures, efficient conversion technologies, and much more intermittent renewable energy sources to convert to 100% renewable energy. I believe also that compared to 5 years ago, this is also a much more present debate at the COP, which I personally did not anticipate when I looked at past experiences. So what we believe is that it is a technical option to do this change. I also believe it is a technique. It's within economic reach, but we need to go away from looking at the electricity sector only. What we always hear is that we need electricity storage, we need carbon capture, we need to have new transmission lines. Now, electricity in Europe, for example, only represents 20 to 30% of the energy demand. The rest is transport and heat. We need to understand we do not make this transition cost effectively if we focus on storing electricity from solar panels in individual houses. We have looked at the cost of storage. The cost of storing in electricity is between 1,000 and 10,000 times higher than storing energy in thermal storages or in gaseous storages or in liquid storages. Now, of course, I recognize you cannot make heat into electricity, but if we know that the heat demand is 50% of what we need in Europe from the energy supply, then we can put in an intermediate where we can use the heat storage, where we can provide the flexibility we need for the intermittent resources. This is what we call a smart energy system approach. We move away from looking at a single sector, and we move into a world where we integrate heat, electricity, and transport, and using all media, including gaseous and liquid storage. The energy system that we have today, we have all of the storage options on the supply side when we put in coal, biomass, natural gas, or oil. We need to put that storage into our energy system, which means that we need to redesign it and rethink it. And in doing that, we need to look at the whole system instead of looking at the silos of the energy system. Silo thinking is too expensive. You can have a look at how we have done that in the EDA Energy Vision, and you can go to our homepage, smartenergysystems.eu. When we do calculations of this, we also identify that there are more jobs in a renewable energy system than in a fossil energy system. We also identify what the lower costs are for the health, and they are very significant because we stop burning and we start using intermittent renewable energy sources. I hope that you got the message today that we can reach the 100% renewable goal, but that it matters how we do it. Thank you.
So I'm going to talk today about how we achieve everything that the panel has been discussing today. The easy answer, we need to work together. But how do we work together? That's not an easy question. Last week was the announcement of Mission Innovation, and there's been a lot of focus on the doubling of R&D spend. But more importantly, it's the commitment to work together. And we were commissioned 6 months ago by the UK's Foreign Office and the UK Department of Energy and Climate Change to come up with some ideas of how we achieve that, how we put Mission Innovation into practice, given that the ambition is that that is operational by June, in a very short time frame. So we've combined all those insights based on talking to business, to government, to the multinationals, to academia, to the finance community, gathering all their insights and presenting some ideas of how this could be done. And we've combined those into a publication called United Innovations, the link to which is on the PowerPoint page there. So firstly, what is international collaboration on innovation? On the technology side, this isn't research happening in labs. A lot of the technologies are available and need to be commercialized within this decade. And that is achievable, but some of the demonstration, for instance, of CCS, of bulk storage technologies, will cost billions of dollars. By collaborating, we could share that cost. We can also share what we learn from those demonstrations, from working together. But maybe more importantly, if we combine all that activity, that creates a larger market. And ultimately, it will be business which will need to make the most investment, and business needs to see attractive markets. Collaboration provides them those markets. Also, collaboration is not the opposite of competition. Governments work together to put together the policies and the enabling environments to make competition as attractive and possible from business. This is also not about just technology. We need new business models, for instance, to make storage attractive, and we need best practice policies and regulations to enable those business models. Why collaborate? We've calculated that through R&D, we can reduce the cost of deploying low-carbon clean technologies over the next decade by $500 trillion. That's a massive grant. And in terms of what's already happening, there are already hundreds of multilateral and bilateral agreements. It's quite easy to sign up to a press release and say we're going to do something. It's very different to then put that into practice. And from talking to a lot of the different institutions in this area, we saw a lot of very good intentions. There are a lot of roadmaps, there are a lot of committees, but there are very few examples where action has been achieved and true collaboration has been unlocked. So talking to the experts in this area, we've compiled some ideas of how to unlock them. This framework, which I'll guide you through, gives an idea of how this can be achieved. It would be different for every single technology, but I'll give you the overall view. So first we need commitment. Doubling R&D spend, that's an input. But just as important is a focus on the output. What are we going to achieve? For instance, making clean energy cheaper than dirty energy. Secondly, we need very clear direction. There are only a handful of technologies which will have the impact required over the next decade in the short term to reach the decarbonation paths required. There are need to be very clear challenges of how we achieve that, not just at the technology level, but at the system level. For instance, how do you get renewables to work together with storage with demand-side response technologies and combined as a system be cheaper than the legacy systems based on fossil fuels. And finally, we need action plans with very clear next steps and responsibilities to put this into action. How do we achieve this? Through greater coordination. There needs to be greater transparency and collaboration between everybody so that everybody knows what everybody else is doing. From the UK, it's hard enough even to track within the UK what the different research institutions are doing. And we need to do that globally. We need to share what we learn, and then we need to put it into practice. And to enable that, we need to have the right policies and the right regulations. When it's appropriate, we need to standardize to maximize the size of the market. And finally, we need program design. Getting collaboration to work in practice is not easy. I can give you one example where the Carbon Trust have just tried to do so. We run the Offshore Wind Accelerator, which is the world's largest R&D and demonstration program in offshore wind. And we designed that program, but it's led by industry. And it's taken quite a bit of work, but industry now comes together and co-invests into the different technologies, leveraging up each one of the pounds that they invest, and sharing that across industry with competition from the government. We need to implement that, and that's right across the different stages of development. So not just in labs, but through to incubation, through engagement with the investors and venture capital community, through to pilots demonstration, but right through to deployment to commercialization. And finally, we need to make sure we're actually having the impact that's achieved. And we need to monitor that, feed that back into the front. So in summary, we need to apply this kind of framework, and this is just an idea, to the different technologies. And in our publication, we have examples of doing so for a handful of the key technologies required. And with a final thought, we've all come together over the last 2 weeks here at COP in Paris. When you go home on your trains and planes, feel free to break out of the little bubbles that sometimes we work in, carry on networking and act.